Hello friends, welcome to the series lecture on digital system design using Verilog. In this video we are going to discuss about design methodology. The topics what I'm going to cover is design flow, design optimization, design for test. So in the case of design flow, we are going to talk about architecture exploration, functional design, functional verification. We are going to talk about the difference between simulation and synthesis. We are going to talk about physical design. In the case of design optimization, we need to optimize for area, timing and power. How we are going to verify the chip? Nothing but design for test. The first one is fault models and fault simulation, scan design and boundary scan, built-in self-test. This built-in self-test is very, very important. And also we are going to talk about non-technical issues. This non-technical issues consists of non-recurring engineering cost, also product cycle. So all these things we are going to discuss in this video. Let us start with design methodology. This chapter is an extension of chapter 1. So first topic is design flow. What do you mean by design flow means? So in the case of design flow, you have to remember this flow chart. First thing is, if you want to come up with one product means, what you have to do is, the first step is you have to write the requirements and constraints. Next, you have to undergo with architecture exploration and partitioning, nothing but you have to classify which falls under hardware and which falls under software. That one you are going to design and then you are going to verify with the help of opposite blocks, nothing but software need to be verified with the help of hardware unit and hardware unit should be verified with the help of software verification. If both the things are okay, then you have to go with software integration as well as hardware integration and verification. If each and everything is good, then go for synthesis, post-synthesis verification. Then you have to fabricate the device, nothing but go for physical implementation. So in this physical implementation, you're going for PSPICE tool or Xilinx tool. Then you will be running some test cases, that is called a synthesis. That is achieved with the help of physical verification. If the simulation results as well as synthesis results are the same, then you will be going for manufacture. At last the chip will be there, so hardware testing will be done. So in testing the hardware, you will be having a black box model, gray box model and white box model. Next, let us talk about architectural exploration. So in this architectural exploration, in order to do a design, the main constraints is the performance and cost, also power. So always there is a trade-off between power dissipation and performance. If performance is good, then power dissipation will be more, thereby there is a decrease of battery backup. This is a disadvantage. So here they have explained how you are going to classify logical and physical partitioning. Main thing is, in the case of VLSI industry, you are going to bifurcate analog components and digital components. So in between to this, you're going to make use of thick oxide, nothing but thick silicon dioxide you're going to pour. Here you're going to bifurcate analog components and digital components, because there should be no any interference between analog to digital signals or digital to analog signals. So in the case of functional design, we'll be talking about intellectual property. Each and every circuit we are not going to manufacture on our own. What we are going to do is, we are going to depend on intellectual property, nothing but we are going to take an IP product. So what we are going to do is, already the product has been tested, we are going to integrate and we will be testing whether the product is working fine or not. Say suppose we have come up with one new product, at that time what we are going to do is, we are going to register the product, and the product design is our own design and nobody should copy the design unless our prior permission. That is what we mean by intellectual property. So violation of intellectual property rights leads to severe financial damage, nothing but you have to pay a penalty in terms of several lakhs or crores. In order to fabricate a chip, we can go with ASIC design or FPGA design. If the design is application specific, then we will be going with ASIC design, and if the design is general purpose, then you will be going for FPGA design, nothing but Xilinx core generator. So you will be having several verification. The first one is logical verification, the second one is design under test, and the third one is functional verification. In my first chapter, I have discussed with hardware or software co-verification, nothing but all the hardware components you are going to test it with the help of software, and software components you are going to test it with the help of hardware. Now look at over here, you want to design a product. So Floor planning has been done. Next, what you're going to do is go for simulation. If each and everything is good, you'll be going for synthesis. So in this synthesis process, you'll be making use of a Xilinx tool, or you'll be making use of piecewise software. So what you're going to do is, virtually you're going to place a component, and then you're going to test for, or you're going to check for setup time, hold time, and propagation delay. All those things you are going to check. If this condition is getting true, then only you will be manufacturing the product. And one more thing, all the test cases manually you can't check. So what you're going to do is, you're going to provide to a system, and you're going to provide the test cases also. At last, you're going to compare the data sheets. If each and every test cases is correct, then you will be proceeding with your design. If not, you will be going back, and then you are going to rectify the faults. In the case of physical design, first step is floor planning, second one is placement, and the third one is routing. In the case of physical design for ASIC, the first step is floor planning, the second step is placement, and the third step is routing. Say suppose you want to construct a house, the first step is flooring. The next one is, you're going to make a demarcation line that which part is room and which part is hall. All those things you're going to make a physical partition, and then you're going to perform routing. So this is a simple example how you're going to manufacture a chip versus how you're going to construct a house. Now look at over here, what is meant by the term architectural exploration? What is the distinction between logical partition and physical partition? Logical partition means, say suppose in the case of microprocessor 8086, it consists of 1 MB of memory. You will be dividing into 4 segments: data segment, code segment, stack segment, extra segment. All these segments you are going to draw, or you are going to bifurcate virtually, or logical partitioning will be there. It is not a physical partition. But in the case of house and all, you'll be making several rooms. That several rooms is a physical partition. So you should know what is the difference between a logical partition and physical partition. What is behavioral model of a component? What is its purpose? What do you mean by an IP? IP reuse, this is very, very important. What do you mean by code coverage? All those things are very, very important. Next, in the case of design optimization, the first one is area optimization, and the second one is timing optimization, and the third one is power optimization. In the case of area optimization, one example is scaling. So in the case of VLSI chips, if you want to reduce the size of the transistor, what you are going to do is, either you are going to reduce the length of the transistor or width, or you are going to reduce the power supply, nothing but VDD, or even you will be talking about thick oxide also, or thin oxide also. So this is what you mean by area optimization. Each and every transistor, if you are minimizing the area, then you can accommodate more and more number of transistors, nothing but you can increase the features. Next one is, in the case of timing optimization, the link budget concept is very, very important, and timing budget is very, very important. You're going to talk about setup time, and you're going to talk about hold time, and you're going to talk about the propagation delay. Say suppose if you want to communicate from one block to another block, so if you want to send the data from one block to another block, it is taking say 1 nanoseconds of time. If you want to further reduce this 1 nanoseconds, you have to check with all the components that is placed over here. What is the propagation delay of each and every mini blocks that are placed over here? How can you optimize the delay is very, very important. And the lowest level of abstraction is register transfer level. In my previous video, I have talked about multiplexer also. Let me not go through it. You need to talk about power optimization. Most of the devices, what we are using is a portable device. Portable device rely on battery backup. So the main thing is how best you can optimize the power consumption. So if you're not using your laptop, what the best you can do is, you can switch your laptop to sleep mode or hibernation mode. Thereby you can save the power. In order to save the power, you need to put some transistors into off state. So in the case of power optimization, you'll be having, especially you need to talk about power dissipation. We are having two variants of power dissipation. The first one is static power dissipation, and the second one is a dynamic power dissipation. If the design is full of CMOS design, then static power dissipation is approximately equals to zero, but dynamic power dissipation will be there. That is given by FCL VDD square. So main thing is, when you're using the laptop, that is dynamic power dissipation. When you're putting your laptop into sleep mode or hibernation mode, what is the power consumption? That is denoted by static power dissipation. or if you're not opening any user application, then the power that is getting dissipated is a static power dissipation. In the case of fault models, you need to talk about stuck at 1 and stuck at 0. Let me consider this example. This point is stuck at 1, nothing but whenever A equals to 1, at that time Z equals to 1, whenever A equals to 0, Z equals to 0, nothing but Z is not a function of B and C. It is defined as stuck at 1. Say suppose if this point could have been stuck at 0, then in each and every iterations of A, B, C, Z would have retained 0 state. So this one, how you are going to identify is a big question. Next, let us talk about scan design and boundary scan. Why you are going for scan design and boundary scan? Say suppose you are having a particular design. In this particular design, you have to test for the test cases. So you will be having some lakhs of test cases. So you are going to generate all the lakh test case, and then if you are verifying, it will be a time consuming process. So in order to reduce the time as well as manpower, what you are going to do is you are going to prefer scan design or boundary scan, nothing but you will be scanning at the particular test points only. If that particular test point is facing some problem, so you are going to check those particular blocks, thereby you are going to reduce the testing complexity. Next, let me consider this circuit. So based on this circuit, I'll be talking about white box model, black box model, as well as gray box model. So in the case of white box model, you'll be accessed for each and every pin in the case of white box model, so the testing will become easy. Whereas if I'm considering about black box model, these are my set of inputs and these are my set of outputs. What is there inside, you'll not be having any idea. So in order to test for this kind of circuits, what you require is you require some test cases. Give the input, get the output, you check the output with the data sheet. If you are getting the proper result, it's well and good. If not, you have to go with this design. That is with respect to black box model. Especially in the case of gray box model, you'll be having only some particular test points. Say suppose you are having this test point as well as this test point and output you are having. So you will not be having access with intermediate test points like this. So this is the drawback in the case of gray box model, nothing but hardly few test points will be available. So based on that, you are going to verify whether you are getting the proper logic or not. Once again, I am going to repeat, in the case of white box model, you will be having an access to each and every node or a test point. But in the case of black box, you will be having access only at the output. In the case of gray box model, you will be having only at particular test points only. Next, let us talk about boundary scan. So in the boundary scan, what you are going to do is you are going to scan only at the boundaries. So some test points they are going to give. So you are going to scan only at the boundaries. How you are going to test the boundary with the help of Verilog or VHDL elements with the help of boundary scan description language, that is also called as BSDL. So you will be having a piece of code, or you can verify using VHDL or Verilog by writing boundary scan description language, which is a subset of VHDL. It also specifies the pins, register and instruction implemented in a test logic of a component. So if I'm making use of boundary scan description language with the help of JTAG architecture, my testing time will get reduced and 100% testing can be done, so that I can increase the product lifecycle or the issue faced by a customer will be drastically reduced. Next, let us talk about built-in self-test. It is also called as BIST. So in order to overcome the scan design problem and boundary scan, we are going for built-in self-test, nothing but if you are testing using scan based design and boundary scan design, you have to generate all the sort of test vectors and you'll be having only some specific test points, nothing but in the case of gray box model, you'll be having limited test points. In the case of white box model, you'll be having each and every test points. That each and every test points you should not give access to an end user. So this is one of the drawback. And in the case of black box model, you'll not be giving provisions for the user. This is in the case of black box model. What built-in self-test will do is it will generate test vectors at full system speed. Thereby, the time taken in order to test the test cases will be drastically reduced. The further advantage is that BIST hardware remains available during the operation lifetime of the system and can be used for testing when the system is in the field. This is very, very important. There are two main aspects to consider while designing a best implementation. How to generate the test patterns is very, very important, and how to analyze the output response to determine whether it is correct or not. Say suppose you want to realize a AND gate. At that time, what you are going to do is you are going to make use of a truth table as a reference. When A and B are my inputs, output is A dot B, nothing but A AND with B. You are going to call it as Y. For 0, 0, I should get it as 0. For 0, 1, it is 0. For 1, 0, it is 0. For 1, 1, it is 1. So based on this, you are going to test for the test cases. In a case of built-in self-test, we are going to make use of pseudo random test pattern generator. Also, you are going to make use of linear feedback shift registers in order to test the components. Let us discuss non-technical issues. In this non-technical issues, you have to talk about non-recurring engineering cost, which is a one-time cost. Thereby, in order to establish a factory or in order to establish an industry, you have to make a dead investment. That is what you mean by non-recurring engineering cost. Or if you are designing a product, the first product, that one will come under non-recurring engineering cost. These things you can't put a blame on a customer or an end user. So in this non-technical issues, you need to talk about product life cycle. Apart from this product life cycle, you need to talk about time to market. These two aspects are very, very important. What do you mean by product life cycle? Say suppose you have purchased a cell phone. If it is lasting for only for 1 year, after 1 year you are facing several issues. At that time, from next year onwards, you will not be preferring that kind of cell phones, or that company cell phone you are not going to prefer. So you'll be switching to some other company cell phone. So this is what we mean by product life cycle. Product life cycle should be more. In order to increase this product life cycle, proper testing mechanism the company should adopt. Why the company is not going to invest much on testing means manpower is required, as well as time to market they can't achieve. Moreover, cost involved will be more. So what do you mean by time to market? Time to market is a function of profitability. Say suppose you have to launch the product at this time. Before, if you are launching, or after, if you are launching, you will not be getting much of the profit. Exactly this is what you mean by time to market. Say suppose one company, it has properly established, after some years the profit will drastically reduce. Nothing but the commodity will not be selling at the initial rate only. So always there will be an increase or decrease in a demand. So this is what we mean by time to market. Next, let us brief what we have studied till now. A design methodology codifies the process of design, verification and preparation for manufacture of a product. It involves development of virtual prototypes to support design analysis and refinement. Architectural exploration is the process of modeling and evaluating candidate design at a high level of abstraction. A system is partitioned for subsequent refinement. Logical partition identifies functional components, whereas physical partition identifies physical hardware components. Logical functions are mapped onto physical partitions. Next, we are having several verifications. One such method is logical verification and functional verification. In the functional verification, it ensures that the refined design meets functional requirements and can be performed using simulation and formal verification. Functional coverage is the proportion of functionality that is going to be verified. So we need to talk about what is the difference between a simulation and synthesis. And you need to talk about fault model coverage, also testability of a circuit that can be enhanced by adding test hardware. Scan design involves modifying registers to form shift register for shifting test vector into a circuit and output results out. Boundary scan, including that specified by the JTAG standard, supports in-circuit testing of components and PCBs. So built-in self-test is very, very important, and boundary scan is also very, very important. They can ask you write a short notes on built-in self-test or boundary scan. So this built-in self-test is a part of DSD as well as VLSI also. So built-in self-test adds autonomous test circuits to components for use in manufacture and in field testing. Various non-technical issues affect the design process, including business and life cycle consideration. In this, you need to talk about product life cycle also, and you need to talk about time to market. So in this video, I have discussed about design methodology. This completes digital system design using Verilog. If you followed with my lecture, please give it a big thumbs up. Also, share this video with your friends and don't forget to subscribe to my channel, Precise Study. Thank you. All the best for your exams.